Yuri, I am Local Food Systems Small Farms Educator out of Kankakee, Wheel and Grundy. That's unit number 9. And we are going to talk about raising sheep, goats, or both. The two get along very well, so you can raise both of them. First of all, disclaimer here, I am not an animal scientist. But in my 6.5 years here in Kankakee, I have been organizing workshops for sheep and goat producers, and I have acquired enough information, just enough to be dangerous, and this is what I'm going to share with you. And what we are going to do is skim through the surface of a whole lot of different topics about these two animals. If I call them small ruminants, you know what I'm talking about. And if also I show a bias towards goats, it's because I have more exposure to goats than to sheep. Okay, so I'm on the first slide. You got my name there. You got my phone number and the email. So in case you have any questions, I don't have all the answers. We have a good network, and the answers can be provided to you as soon as you ask those questions. So why do we want to raise sheep and all goats, one or the other or both? The biggest reason is the meat consumption, for meat. That's the main reason why we want to raise these animals, the small ruminants, because as you can see the last sentence there, we have very many niche markets for goat and sheep products. There are very many immigrants coming to the U.S. that eat these animals elsewhere in the world, and they require the meat from these animals. Some people keep them for wool and fiber. There are not so many of them. Others will keep them for milk, and from the milk, they'll make cheese and yogurt, value-added products. About a month ago, when we had a sheep and goat workshop, somebody did show us that he was making belts and women's passes from the skin of goat hides. And then other people, we also in the audience last time in the workshop, we did have somebody here who talked to us about breeding show animals. So that's something else people get into. Sheep and goats can be companion animals, and here I'm not talking about them being companion animals like dogs. They can be companion animals for bigger animals like cows or horses. And what they do is, they are able to eat what the cows and horses don't want to eat. They are weed busters. And then, of course, they are ideal for small farms. They are easier to handle. Younger people and ladies can handle this with ease and all those good reasons. The other thing about their meat is indicated in this table here. The very first column shows the different types of meat: goat, beef, pork, chicken, and lamb. And the calories that you get from, the second column is the calories that you get from a unit serving. And you can see that goat and chicken provide the least amount of calories, but then that also comes with other good things, because you go to the next column there, the fat content. You have very little fat in goat and chicken meat, but the least is from the goats. And then you look at the saturated fat column, it's less than one unit compared to everybody else. Chickens have 1.1 amount of saturated fat. What that means is when you have saturated fat, you don't have any double bonds. When you have double bonds, there is a small cartoon that's not showing very well at the bottom there. When you have double bonds, you have a more digestible molecule. So when you have unsaturated fats, that's desirable. Saturated fats are not that easy to digest, and therefore that's a problem. So goat meat is the meat of choice in this particular instance. The source of this information is a USDA handbook of 1989. Next slide. Why do we want to raise sheep and or goats? There are also many advantages that are outlined in this slide, as well as disadvantages. The best of them all is that for the two animals, the two small ruminants, they live, they can eat poor quality forage and convert that to both meat and milk easily. Indeed, sheep and goats, if you go to Africa and other places, you find that they are mostly raised in the savanna where you have the tough, coarse grass, and which they're able to convert very well into meat and milk. In Texas and California and other drier places in this country, they do very well too. That's not to say they don't, and we shall see this in a little while, that's not to say they are not also raised in high productive areas. And then you also have a quick return on investment. That's the other thing with these two small ruminants. The different niches of customers that there are, some require animals that are 6 months old for meat. Others will require yearlings. Others don't care. Like, as people from Africa, we don't care how big it is. The bigger the better, that means more meat. But people from, say, Spain want yearlings. Or less. So there are all sorts of, and Jews. Jews also require younger ones. So there are all sorts of different market opportunities out there. A quick return on investment. The younger it is also, the more expensive it is. Oh, and another thing too, these animals are prone to predation much more than any other livestock, other than, of course, chickens. Therefore, your fencing has to be a little bit more elaborate to keep what you want kept out and to keep what you want kept in. I'm on the next slide. It's showing the production of sheep in the United States. And I want to say at this point that both sheep and goats came way back when, 1500, they were introduced into this country, so they've been around for a long time. But prior to 1945, which is the Second World War, end of Second World War, mutton was a big preferred meat in this country. But after 1945, you can see that dip there, everything going down. The reasons given are that the dollar, first of all, appreciated so too much. When the dollar is very strong, exports become difficult because people don't want to pay too much. When it is weak, there are more exports, more goods going out of the country. Then there was sensitization of the citizenry in this country that dogs, wild dogs, coyotes, and those kind of wild animals that used to be shot indiscriminately because they are predating on sheep became more protected. And then third, there was more industrialization, and those people that used to be shepherds or herding sheep and goats found jobs in industry, so that was, it became a bit more difficult to raise this animal. But it's been going down. You can see up to, in the beginning, it was about more, an average of about 50 million animals. 2005, it had come down to less than approximately 5 to 6 million animals. And then I was curious about production of sheep and goats in this country, so I went to the National Agricultural Statistics Service of this year, and I checked on the numbers, the census of lambs and goats. That's the left column would be the sheep, and the right column would be the goats. And what you see there is that Texas tops everybody else in both sheep and goats. And if you examine the numbers again, Texas is the only one that shows an increase in production from 1 year to the next as far as sheep goes. With goats, they came down a little bit. And if you look at the two columns of 2010 and 2011, numbers went down slightly. And we'll look at that again a little bit. I was interested to find out where Illinois is in the whole scheme of things. And as far as sheep go, we are number 25. And as far as goats go, we are number 23. And at first I thought maybe we just can't do any better because we are way too far north. And I thought that, for instance, goats don't do very well because of the winter here. And then I started seeing some other states there, Oregon, which one is southern one, which is northern. For the sheep, Iowa is up there in the, well, sheep are better because they can tolerate cold much better than goats. But probably the reason we are not doing very well with goats is because they can't tolerate the cold that well. However, as we shall see in a little while, people who provide them with proper housing so that they don't get too cold do well, nevertheless. And 2012, I'll be checking what is happening this year come 2013. They'll be having the data in January of 2013. I'm on to the next slide. I got closer to home now in Illinois. And again, just to show that even in Illinois, the trend of decline in production is happening here too, for both sheep and goats. And somebody did just ask a question here, why the goats have gone down in production. And there's one reason given, that the government did have an incentive where people are to produce goats for wool and meat, and then that was taken away. So that disincentivized those who are already doing it. That's one reason. There may be other reasons. We'll discuss that a bit later. Down there at the bottom, I've shown you that in the year 2011, there was 5.5 million sheep. That was 2% less than 2010. So the decline is showing there. Goats were 3 million, which was 1% less than 2010. Next slide. You may not have this in your handout. I just threw it in there because I thought this was an interesting observation. The pink columns show the inventory of goats in the United States, and the white columns show the number of farms with the amount of inventory that is shown. And so many farms in the United States, you see 52.4%, have fewer than 10 goats on that farm. And there must be a good reason why they are keeping less than 10 goats, otherwise they wouldn't be around. 52.4%, that's more than half. I presume that these would be the show goats where you don't need so many of them, or maybe some people just want to keep a few for, you know, pets, maybe. I don't know what the other reason might be. You look at the last two columns there where they are talking about 500 or more goats on a farm. Less than 1% have 500 or more of goats. In the center there, they talk about 10 to 499 goats on a farm. And again, about half the number of farms have that number. Well, they give a very big range. I would have liked to see 10 to 50, 50 to 100, because again, that the biggest distribution would have been on the 10 to 50 and maybe 50 to 100. That's where most numbers lie of people that produce goats in the U.S. Next slide. If you are thinking about keeping goats or sheep, Dick Cobb, who is our sheep and goat specialist in Illinois, has a very good publication, and he tells you to ask yourself a few questions even before you start. Do you like these animals? Are you going to be worried that you can't go on vacation when you want to? Or do you have somebody else that can support you, either in the family or somebody else that can take care of your animals? Remember that the animals need food, water, 24/7, 365. How much land do you have? If you have very small land and you want to keep so many animals, are you going to buy the feed and the hay? what's the productivity of your land? Maybe you have very sandy soil and you can't do very well with pasture. Do you want these goats, the five or six maybe, as companion animals? And what kind of forage do you have? Are you going to practice rotational grazing? All that stuff. Do you have buildings? We just talked about goats not taking the weather very well when it gets to be very cold. Indeed, when it gets very hot too, they want some shade. Our farmer here who is in Kankakee, his name is Rick Adams. He leaves his sheep out on the pasture 364 and a half days a year. The half day is when they come in for sharing, all of them. Besides all of them coming in for sharing, the mamas that are going to have babies or when they have had their lambs, they do come in because you don't want the shock that the lambs can have out there on in the cold or in snow or something like that. And any old buildings can be used, the machine sheds, barns, etc. You can convert those to their places to live in. And they should always be open, cool, and dry. You don't want them tight because if they are tight, warm, and humid, you're just inviting opportunities for disease in these animals. Next slide, still about beginning. Do you have the necessary machinery and equipment to do what you want to do? Some small equipment. You want to be, okay, before you get to small equipment, fencing will be your biggest capital investment, most likely, because you need to keep animals out, and we'll talk a bit about fencing in a little while. You need to be tagging the animals. You want to be trimming the hooves. You want to be shearing them. Now, if you're going to need 100 tons of hay, for instance, it's probably cheaper to buy than to produce your own. There's too much capital investment up front to warrant, to justify your 100 tons is not enough to justify too much investment in equipment. And then do you have enough time on your hands? Most people that will keep 20, 30, 40 goats or sheep are probably on a second job. They just want to wake up at 4:30 a.m. in the morning, give the animals some water and feed if it's hay, and then take off, come back and see them in the evening. Now, that has worked for a few people that I've talked to. If you have more animals than that, or if you and your spouse are not quite in agreement about these animals, then there can be problems. Now, there's a sentence there about walking your animals often. This game is not just about putting in the feed and water and taking off. You need to hang around. You need to see who is standing on their own there, who is not feeding, who is not waking up when you come there, who is thin. You need to be looking at some of these things, and the earlier you catch a symptom and take remedial action, the better. Do you have the money to start what you want to do? Ours is to tell people whether you have a lot of money or little money, start small. Start with five goats or five sheep. If you can take care of those this year, next year you can take care of 10. Grow gradually. And then, goes without saying, no brainer, you have to be well informed. You have to read. You have to research. That's why you're here. And then you have to talk to other people who have been doing what you want to do. They are the best teachers. My 6 years have taught me that people who are keeping animals are your best teachers. Next slide, goal setting. I threw this one in here again because we get people calling us, you know, saying, I want to keep goats or I want to keep sheep. And you ask them, why do you want to keep sheep? I don't know. You tell me why I should keep them. No, you need to know, I want to do dairying. I want to do dairying because I want to produce yogurt. I want to produce soap with goat milk. If you have set up a goal, then we can now help you much better. We can find the necessary resources for you. So I won't go through this list, but you need to think about this when you think you want to keep these animals. Read, research, talk to other people, set some goals. And the next slide, too, is also about goals. And just to recapitulate a little bit here, goals will depend on what resources you have, your capability to manage, the time you have, and that kind of thing, and the product that you hope to raise. Don't just start off and then decide what you want to do with your goats after you've had them. Next slide, nutrition. Nutrition will be your biggest cost in this operation. It goes without saying. And to repeat myself again, goats and sheep are efficient users of low-quality forages, and you see that very well if you go to Texas or go to Africa. They live on kind of forages you don't want to put your dairy cows on because it's just poor in nutrition, but these guys are good at converting them. Having said that, that forage may need to be supplemented with grains or other concentrated feeds to meet shortfalls. A newborn is very fast growing. It's building up muscle and bone and can't just live on pasture alone, for instance. It's building a whole lot, and we're going to see that in a moment. A lactating mom gets worn out or gets devastated when it has three kids or three lambs. It needs a whole lot more feed, a lot more food to meet that shortfall and to rebuild its own body. Certain minerals are deficient in the Midwest. In this area, for instance, selenium is in short supply. But, and we'll talk about it later, the mineral block or the salt block should have that to supplement the shortcoming. And then if you're really interested into going into the profit that you're making, if you're keeping animals for meat, you want to decide, I want to sell live weight at $1. It's got to be based on your inputs, and in that $1, there is your profit as well. It may be $1.50, it may be $2, but you need to check what you are putting in so that you can get a profit out of the animals. That's the whole idea. And there it's also mentioned that an average doe or ewe needs about 1 ton of hay per year. Quite expensive. That's just one doe. And I also mentioned down there if your hay equivalent, so if your land productivity is known and there are ways of calculating this, then you can tell how many animals per acre you can keep. Generally, 5 or 6 goats or 5 or 6 sheep per acre are the average figure. On very good pasture, you can go a bit higher. On poor pasture, now you might have to keep fewer animals. And down there, I also say there is a program called Ilina Graze, which you can Google. It will help you determine the carrying capacity of your land. It asks you a few questions. I noticed that the numbers here have become messed up by the picture that I have over there, but you have the good numbers on your handouts. These are the nutritional requirements of these animals, in this case, the buck or the ram, the doe or the ewe. It's about the same thing. These numbers are the requirements by these animals at different stages of their life. The yearling, which is about a year old, requires quite much higher amounts of protein compared to other stages. The lactating doe, let me see whether that's correct. Yeah, the high producing doe also requires quite a bit more of protein than other stages of development. But generally, 12% is the amount of crude protein that is needed by these animals. More than that is just pissed off. I mean, comes out as urine, it's not utilized. And then these animals require energy, what we also call the total digestible nutrients. And you know that the younger the grass, for instance, the more digestible it is and the more nutrients you have. You wait for your grass to become fibrous and tall and all that. It's not chewable. It's not digestible. You get less of nutrients. So The requirement for that is also given here for the different stages or different types of animals. Now, I keep saying if you're buying feed or if you're buying hay, that's your single biggest cost in your operation. If you have a pasture and you can go as long as you can on that pasture, you very significantly save, because you can see 70% of the cost of raising these animals is simply the feed. And so Rick Adams, who leaves his sheep and sheep 364 and a half days a year out there, saves very much. And so the amount of feed given to an animal will depend on its age, weight, stage of growth, and the breeding cycle, as we just saw in one or two slides back. A weaned lamb or kid requires some special diet. This animal is very vigorously growing, developing muscles. The ruminants have four different stomachs. This young one has not developed the four stomachs properly, so it can't eat grass right away. It's got to go on creep feed, which again is in high concentration with protein. And that small structure you see there is a creep feeder. It's only accessible to the yearling. The adult, the mature ones, cannot get in there. So it keeps them out. Developing animals have their different need. Again, females in late pregnancy. First of all, remember that if one of these animals has two or three kids in her belly, it is really pushing on the stomach. She never has enough to eat. So she needs to be given a little more than everybody else. And then lactating mothers, Rick Adams, when he was here last time, he showed us a picture of one mother with three lambs. She was really thin. You could count the ribs one after another. But they get worn out. Next slide. You don't have this slide, but you see the... See the title here, Characteristics of Forage and Pasture Species Grown in Vermont. But the point here is when you establish pasture, it's almost always with a mix of different grasses, because different grasses have different traits. Some can be trodden on without any problem. They come up. Others will survive the winter much better. Others will tolerate low fertility. Others will do well in the fall, in the spring, but not in the heat of the summer. You got to have a mix so that you always have pasture going. And therefore, what I did was to, my next slide here, I went in and blew up this last slide that I just showed you, just to show three grasses up there. And if you look at smooth brown grass, for instance, and you go to the periods of production, you see that, let me use the pointer here, you see that it can be grown in spring, summer, and fall. So you might think, okay, why don't I just use smooth brown grass, which is growing throughout the year? But you go back two columns behind where we talk about soil moisture adaptation, and you find that smooth brown grass will not stand clay soil. It wants well-drained soil. And indeed, we do recommend smooth brown grass in areas that have sandy soils. It does very well. So you need to look at other grasses, maybe Timothy grass and all others, which you need to mix with. And you always add a little bit of clover, a good source of protein, but you never want clover or the leguminous plant to be more than 30%, because now you start taking the risk of bloat in the animals. And the next slide, okay. The next slide shows an example of a pasture mix. I took this. This is a company that had this, and I removed the name of the company. But you see, when you ask them for a pasture mix and you are in the northern Illinois, you see a map of the U.S. showing the northern states here, less some of them. If you are in those northern states, this pasture mix is supposed to work well. And you see, if you look at the first column there, you have 35% orchard grass, 30% smooth brown grass, 30% forage tall fescue, and 5% Ladino clover. So that will work well for many places. But again, I caution you, before you jump into buying this one, you need to have your soil tested. You need to, your conditions need to be well known before you jump into any of these. It shows you also the planting rate and the planting times. Good information. Ellen Phillips will be talking in, on March 29. We'll probably deal with a bit more about pastures. Her topic is pastures. Then again, the next slide, I want to tell people here that grazing is both an art and a science. It's a science because if you overgraze, you've removed the growing part of the and I want to call it a crop. People don't remember that, people don't consider that grass is in itself a crop. So if you remove too much of the, if you overgraze, you just removed the growing part of the grass, and therefore to come back takes much longer now. Now, if you haven't, in the second square there, if you have not delineated, if you haven't made sure that animals don't roam all over the place, but they move from place to place, what we call managed grazing, rotational grazing, or grazing in paddocks, then they take a bite here, they take a bite there, they take a bite there, and grass grows very poorly in patches. If you graze it too short, again, that's not good for regeneration. If you wait for it to grow too tall, first of all, like I just said, the nutritive quality becomes bad, and then you start getting seed development, it's just, again, a waste. So you want to leave it just right, and the rule of thumb usually is if you have 8 inches, graze half, leave 4 inches. Always graze half and leave half. If you have 6 inches, graze 3, and so you're supposed to be walking out there with a measuring stick? No. You just become accustomed to seeing they have raised enough, let them move on. So that's where the art comes in. We talk about water now, and it's the one, I don't know, I've put nutrient there in quote marks. Should I call it a nutrient? I think it should be called a nutrient. Remember this, the body of these small ruminants is 60% water. I mean, the whole body is 60% water. Maybe that's the same case with us. I don't think we are just storing water there for nothing, for no reason. The rumen itself, where digestion is taking place, has 70% water. And research has shown that as soon as the level of the amount of water starts dipping down, the process of digestion becomes affected and all that, and then it has an effect on the animal. You better forget. Okay, so this is one story about somebody who gave their chickens feed and they forgot to give it water. They went to work. They came back at 5. All the chickens were dead. Would have been better if they had forgotten to give the feed and give water. They would have survived. They would have been cranky in the evening, all right, but they would have survived. So water, you cannot assume anything. And then look at the amounts of water that these animals are supposed to consume. The ewe or the doe is supposed to get 2 to 3 gallons per day, and that had better be clean water too. Give them clean water. And you can have automatic waterers, like that sheep down there is drinking from, or you can have the open containers. So come winter, you got to find a way of keeping this water from getting frozen. Even in winter, water is necessary just as much as in summer. And then we just talked about selenium being in short supply in the Midwest. That salt block you see up there is a good one for them to leak. Never force these animals to take the minerals the way you want to. Don't put salt in water, or don't put in the feed whatever you want to give them. Let them leak to their satisfaction. They know when they've had enough. And you can either buy the salt block, or you can use the PVC pipe, that design shown down there. This is powdery form. They'll come and take the little they need and move on. Housing. The small ruminants do not need palaces to live in at all, any old buildings, I reiterate that again, or any simple structures will do. If you have structures such as are shown here and you have directed the door away from the windward side, you're not catching the wind, then that's good enough. Movable shelters are even better because you keep moving the animals around, you keep distributing the manure around. Manure from these small ruminants is much better to manage than the cow pies from cows. So it's a bit easier to get around with these animals as far as manure is concerned. Next slide there that is showing housing and equipment. It's a very busy slide. It's got five pictures. Top left-hand corner, I just want you to note the simple structure this person made using cardboards. The goats are happy in there. The better picture that shows a lot of creativity is the middle one where goats are feeding. They're feeding on hay there. This person came up with a brilliant idea where he cut a keyhole type window through which the goats can put their heads in. The behavior with goats when they put their hands in through a hole like that to reach for the feed is to pull it out. Now, with this keyhole structure, when it tries to go backwards, of course, the lower portion of that keyhole can only accommodate the neck, cannot accommodate the head. So, therefore, there's very little wastage. And the material used to construct this hay feeder is really cheap. That's something that you ought to think about. Bottom left-hand corner, the stanchions where you want to stud your goat or sheep for whatever reason. That's also made by picking pieces of lumber, or if you just buy them, it ends up being a very cheap thing to build. The sheep on the top right-hand corner there, they are feeding off of a trough. There must be some feed there. And somebody has done a good job of covering the trough so that when it rains, then the feed doesn't get wet. But look at where the sheep are standing. He never thought about draining that water away. The sheep are standing in water. Now, that's another opportunity for hoof rot or other diseases. And then there's the other structures at the bottom there where the goats can take, well, those are goats in there. They are taking refuge from the sun, I guess. And they seem not to like the center one. They seem to like the two side ones. Some, maybe there's drainage, maybe the poor drainage in the center one, so they don't want to go in there. Whatever reason it is, I don't know. So, be creative. That's the point. Rick Adams, I keep talking about him. I guess he's my master sheep farmer in this area, and Elton Mao. They do have structures like this. This is a hoop building. This is something that you won't get into if you are new. But maybe a few years down in time, or if this becomes a big family business, and he's also dependent on this sheep for his income. So he can afford to invest better housing, more expensive housing, but it hasn't taken, he didn't do that in 2 or 3 years. It's been quite a while. So these might be lambs that are about a year old, and they are in there for finishing before being taken to market. It's probably the same place you bring the mamas who are about to have lambs or those that have just gotten their lambs. Let's talk about some of the breeds. I'm on to the next slide, saying goat breeds. There are five major breeds of goats in the U.S. That will be Boer, Kiko, Myotonic, Savannah, and Spanish. In this slide, I'm showing two of them. The Myotonic one has a gene that allows it to lock up its muscles when frightened or when startled. So when it locks up its muscles, it falls to the ground. One wonders how that kind of a trait would allow this to survive in the wild. If attacked, it should run, not fall to the ground. Then, and it has got excellent meat, and then this is a U.S. breed. It's been bred here, so maybe living with people and people taking care of it is able to survive. The Kiko goat, which we got from New Zealand, was developed for wetter areas. And I've talked to a few people who have told me they couldn't keep another type of breed of goat other than the Kiko. Good conversion of feed, quick rate of growth, you sell it sooner, less maintenance. It's supposed to be an awesome goat to keep here, and it has low maintenance, as I say there. Next slide, the Boer goat. The Boer goat was developed in South Africa, and then it found its way to Australia, New Zealand, and then to the U.S. It could be too big for some people, you know, just too much maintenance, so maybe the costs also become to be a bit more. It has a high rate of weight gain. It gains weight pretty fast. It has excellent body conformation for meat. It has a lot of meat. And indeed, people have now crossed the Kiko and the Boer. And what I've heard, and from a very reputable source, the breeder who is in Kentucky, he says that the offspring do well than either parent. So that's a good thing to do. If you can breed the two, you get better offspring. The one on the left is a mama, probably pregnant. The right one is less than a year old. And the one in the middle is, of course, a buck with a whole lot of personality. Next slide, dairy goats. Dairying, I'm not too much into dairying, and I have met a few people that are doing it. And when I go to Kankakee Fairgrounds, I always see people doing, people showing off dairy goats. I am familiar with the Toggenburg from Africa. It's very adapted, very well adapted in Africa. I'm familiar with that one. And then I can never fail to identify La Mancha because it's the only one that has no ears. And I've seen that too quite a bit. And there are people keeping those. And Europe, it's a big deal because cheese from small ruminants has a high added value. It fetches a whole lot of money. And I don't have much more comment beyond that. Next slide on sheep breeds. Again, I'm only going to comment on the two breeds that I'm familiar with. Rick Adams and Elton Mao, my master sheep producers here, have Suffolk, the breed that's called Suffolk. It's very easily identifiable by its black face, and it is selected for its lamb production, growth rate, feed efficiency, and carcass quality. Last year, Rick Adams had one mother who produced six of them. Now, six of them is just too many for one mama to take care of. He had to be the mama now. He had to suckle, to give them bottled milk, and they all survived, which is good because that's good profit for him. I have those three pictures there showing good body conformation for these animals. You don't want them overly fat, like obese. Neither do you want them really thin. You just want the right body conformation. If you see the hind quarters there, the front there, when it is looking at you, you want the front legs little ways apart. That means there is good enough space between the legs, lots of meat again in the sternum. But again, the center one that is facing sideways, if you look at the back of this sheep and the belly, it's almost parallel. Nothing could be better. That conformation is a grade A. That will score top mark. Of course, this is a picture, but I've seen some that look that nice. You don't want the belly sagging. You don't want the back that is, what's the word? Yes, way back. You want that parallelness. You want that straightness, almost a straight line. I go to Katadin. I've been to two farms where I have seen Katadins, and I also have experience with this in Africa. If I was to keep any small ruminant, I probably would keep the Katadin. It's probably the lowest maintenance animal. They bath on their own in the bushes there, and they are excellent mothers. They take care of the young with utmost care. They're the most docile animals. They grow wool when they need it. When it comes to winter, they grow it. When it comes to summer, they just shed it off. they are probably, well, for me, I guess I'm lazy. Probably my animal of choice. And then they have excellent meat. They will survive easily on forage as well as on pasture. They are excellent, excellent animals. The two people that I went to visit that keep these animals wouldn't keep anything else for $1 million. Okay, so management and then health tasks. There are various questions here, and I have some pictures here. You have a buck, or say the ram, which is hanging around for 11 months doing nothing else but eating, and then maybe just 1 month you use it for breeding. Do you know how to take care of it? They can also become aggressive. They become territorial and they can become aggressive. The picture shown there is of a man holding the beard of a buck. That's the best way to hold him until you find a place where you can take off and run, because they can be territorial too. The next picture there is of a young one suckling. The young one, like I said, has poor developed gastrointestinal system, cannot digest grass. So therefore, you got to supplement him with the right feed. You got to let him suckle and then supplement with the right feed, the creep feed and stuff like that. Do you know how to assist in difficult bathing? There was one time here in a sheep and goat workshop, we had 1 hour of discussion on how to assist a mother where the kid or the lamb is coming out with the legs, with the back leg first, instead of the normal way, the head and the front leg. How do you push it back in and turn it over? You need to learn these things. But otherwise, you put the mother and the kids at risk. It could be heavy loss. The weaning process, when you move the young one from the mother, how are you going to treat the young one now? That's a big issue now. Vaccination is almost a must. Coccidiosis is a disease around here. You have the anti-helminthic worms. You have the Barber pole worm, which is a big problem in this area. We'll look at that in a minute. And then you have issues with internal and external parasite control. Can you drench the animal if it has worms? You have a picture there showing how you insert the syringe into the mouth of the animal. Can you trim hooves? If the pictures on the left there show badly shaped hooves, and after you trim it, how they look nice. And I've seen these animals, once they are trimmed, they jump about. They feel good. It's good for the animals. Next slide, busy slide. I tried to show you a few of the external and internal parasites that you can expect. The KEDS, let me see if I can use the pointer. That would be the KEDS. And then that would be the lice. That would be the mites right there. And this is the condition of the sheep when it has these mites. And these are, of course, the ticks. And then this is a yearling or a young one that you can't see very well, but it's scouring, it's diarrheaing. And the symptom you see there is called a muddy butt. You know, it's like it's been sitting on mud. Over here, you see a coccidial parasite. It's a one-celled organism that causes intestinal and gastrointestinal problems there. It can cause this one as well as Sporidium can cause diarrhea in animals, and that's when you see the muddy butt there with the animals. The Barber pole worm is this one right here. These worms survive in the gut, and they just compete with the animal for the nutrients. It becomes very thin. The tapeworms, you see this white here. That's a tapeworm in the droppings of one of these small ruminants, and it can be long, and it has been eating the food that this animal should have been eating. The meningeal worm, I don't have a picture of it, but the deer that is now being pointed there has managed to jump into the paddock where your fence is supposed to keep this deer out. It can bring in meningeal worms on contact. It can bring in to the sheep or goats, and it's a bad one. Okay, next slide. You don't have to be a doctor, you don't have to be any of those to tell, to be able to tell that this animal is sick, and some of the symptoms that you can go by to determine whether an animal is healthy or not healthy are indicated there, and I did mention them a little while ago. Some common diseases, and I won't go through all of them, but let me tell you there are many. That's not to discourage you from keeping these animals. There are very many described diseases for human beings. How many diseases do we have at any one time? Or sometimes we don't have any at all. So don't be scared that you have to deal with so many diseases. If your animals are well fed, well taken care of, they will, in fact, withstand infection. They will be able to resist the various pathogens that will afflict them. You see the pink eye down there. You see the ringworm, the fungal infection on the skin of that sheep there. And then you have respiratory infections caused by either bacteria or viruses or other causes. Another disease there, once the sheep gets this, caseous lymphadenitis, which you can read about, it accumulates fluid in the body, and that fluid finds its way into the gland in the neck of the animal. So you can see that animal there. Viruses will cause a sheep to really look thin, like this one is looking. Now you see the symptom, but you can't tell what the cause is. Now this is a case for a veterinarian's attention. Scrapie disease, and okay, scrapie, what is scrapie? If you are familiar with mad cow disease, you can call this mad sheep or mad goat disease. It's the equivalent. The cause unknown. There is conjecture as to whether it's some pieces of proteins, which we call prions, that go to the nervous system into the brain, that cause these animals to become affected and confused and fall down and die eventually. Nobody knows. So when you don't know the cause, the cure is not forthcoming. However, people that are going to keep these small ruminants are required to label them so that the epidemiology of this disease can be watched. You know, if you sell your animal and in the processing plant they say this animal had scrapie disease, and I don't know how they determine that, maybe molecular biology methods, then they can always trace it back where it came from and they can isolate that herd. That's the idea. And these tags are free from the USDA. Fencing. I won't read this, but here is the point I want to make. There are laws governing how you erect your fence, how high it is, whether you can even do a fence. There's even that issue. Many areas have zoning laws that say only 4.5 feet or maximum 6 feet. So there are all sorts of laws. Be aware of those. Maybe your biggest capital, I'm on the slide now talking about fencing, the second one on fencing. And you usually have two types of fencing. The perimeter fencing is usually your higher one, the higher one, and the stronger one. Because like I said earlier on, there are animals you want to keep out, and there are others that you want to keep in. And they should not commingle, they should never mix. So that one needs to be well done. The interior can be cheaper, it can be easy, it can be movable even. In fact, when we go on pasture walks, we see how people are marking the boundaries up to where they want the animals to feed using electric fencing, which is sometimes like a netting, or even a single strand of wire. The cows know to respect that single strand of wire if it is electrified. So the fences would serve different purposes and stuff like that. Then I had a little statistic. Let me put it that way. But in the year 2011, you had total losses of about 600,000, over 600,000 lambs and sheep. If you see that, 400 plus 234. And then goats, you had more than 500,000 loss. Of those animals, 39% of the loss in sheep was due to predators. I now know why people want to shoot coyotes and wild dogs. That's a heavy loss to bear. And any loss in your production that causes more than 10%, 10% is already too much to even be, you need to be taking very high remedial measures to get back to 2% or 5%, less than 10%. We're talking about 39% due to predators in sheep and more than 30% in goats. So you have a big issue to deal with here as far as predators go. And there are ways of managing that. Fencing is one. We've already said that. Guard dogs are great. The Pyrenee, that dog there is a Pyrenee. They are awesome dogs. Rick Adams and Elton Mao, they use Pyrenee dogs. They keep Rick Adams with his 300 sheep hasn't had any loss to cut. And he sees them. The coyotes are around, but these dogs are just awesome and at keeping this out. If you have companion animals, and companion animals, I mean llamas and donkeys and maybe horses and cows, you keep away the coyotes. And for the lethal and non-lethal methods would be probably to trap them. I won't say anything about the lethal methods. You decide on that one. The next one is the fence types, and I'm going to jump through this. The first one, if I can point at this, I don't know if I can point. Yeah, that one. Woven wire with barbed wire on top. The squares need to be 4 by 4 inches. Bigger than that, the lambs and the goats start poking their heads through, and if they have horns, they can get trapped in that. You don't want that. And then there's the second type of multiple strands of barbed wire. I haven't seen much of that. The electric fencing, the net fencing is one for subdividing within the paddocks, and all the others that you see there can get more expensive or cheaper depending on the gauge you use, the number of strands you're going to use. If you go on the Equip program, they start specifying what gauge of wire you're going to use, stuff like that. And then this is a picture just talking about the same things I was talking about. You see the lamb at the bottom there, the white lamb there. It will not put its head through that netting. The biggest thing about fencing, well, during the sheep and goat workshop here, the person who talked about fencing, the one thing he emphasized most was make sure that your corner post is stable and sturdy. Your whole fence is dependent, the strength of your whole fence is dependent on that corner post. So always be emphatic at making sure, ensuring that it is the best you have. You've done the best job. Records. Like I said earlier on, if you want to know you're making a profit, you got to keep records. If you want to go to dollars and cents, you got to keep records. On the other hand, if you want to keep some of those animals for breeding, how do you know who the best breeders and who the best mamas are? You got to keep records. There's a simple, suggested chart up there that I just got off of the internet. You can make your own. The bottom one there is what Jennifer and Andy Miller from Champaign do. And you can see they will say what the female was, that's the dam. And of course they know who is breeding the dam, I'm sure they do. And when the newborn comes, it's tagged. And then if you go like so many columns ahead, you see the birth weight. They want to know as soon as it's born, how heavy is it? 30 days later, how heavy is it? 60 days later and 90 days. That tells you this was an animal that had a good weight gain rate. So you want to keep that female. Is it a female for breeding next year? That's the one you want to keep. You want to cull the one that is growing slowly. You want to get rid of that one. And then they also, because they want to go down to dollars and cents, they also mark the very last column. If they sold that one, how much did they sell it for? Because when you decide, like I said earlier on, if you are selling at $1.50 per live weight, you got to know how you arrive at that so that you don't, you're not harming yourself, you're not going at a loss. A little bit of economics, and I know I'm 5 minutes over, I'll finish this in 5 minutes. A little bit of economics, we've already agreed that your biggest cost is hay and feed. That's your biggest cost, okay? So Andy Miller, who keeps his records religiously, came up with his costs, which is shown in this example, where he has two bucks and 23 does. And he has the various costs, and as expected, his biggest cost is the hay. You see it down there. He hasn't put his own time, labor. He has not put the value of the land. Some people will do that. Okay. But he came up with this figure that for the 25 goats, it cost him $121.28 for that season or for that year. That's what he came up with. Then he decided, supposing I wasn't using hay, what would I save? And he now removed the 1,551 from the 3,032 and got 1,481, which brings that down to $60 per animal. So you see how much you can save if you are able to go through on pasture. Granted, we can go 365 days on pasture most of the time, but if you can, if you can do it 6, 7, 8 months instead of just doing 6 months, any extra day, any extra week that you have your animals out on pasture, you're saving some money. That's the point of this slide here, economics. A man called Joel, and I don't know how to pronounce Joel Salatin, says that production is 20% of the effort, marketing is 80% of the effort. We here near Chicago have really not much of a problem with the market, because what I've found out is that the market chases the producers here. Indeed, you have to keep people wanting goats out of your property. You see them coming all the time. Do you have any goats to sell? They always chase you around. So here we are a little bit better off because we are near a very huge population in Chicago, which has Jews, Hispanic people, Africans, Asians, that are all eager to eat lamb or meat from sheep as well as meat from goats. So you can hear, well, it's probably easier for us. Then you follow the festive holidays, which I'm going to talk about in the next slide, but you can also sell via the sale barns. Sale barns don't give you a whole lot of money from what I hear, but you can also sell online. Online Market Maker, most of you have heard of Market Maker. It's a program that you can go online, just Google Market Maker. You can put your name in there and say, I have 20 goats for sale at immediately, available now. And you have people calling you. Or you can also put your name there if you want goats, say, I need goats. Somebody will tell you, yeah, I have some. So it's a two-way process. And if you're doing breeding stock, then you belong to an association. You can always sell via those associations. This is a very busy slide, and I don't want you to read everything. I just want you to take note. Goats and sheep are eaten during some holidays, quite a bit more than other times. Christians will want some, maybe some goat and sheep. See the bottom there, the bottom line, Christmas is on December 25, any which year. It's always 25th. But you look at what I have highlighted in yellow, those are Muslim holidays, and none of them fall the same day of the year. If you look at 2011, 2012, all the way to 2015, there's always a difference in the year. You need to know that so that you can probably adjust your breeding cycle, if you want to ensure that you target those communities. I know I went to buy a goat one time, and it was a day before Ramadan. I went there very early, 7 a.m., and I was told to come back 5 o'clock because the Muslims had said they want 50 or 60 slaughtered that day. And so I knew, now I know not to go and buy just a day or two before Ramadan. So The only one of the Christian holidays that changes with time is, of course, Easter. And also Hanukkah doesn't keep a constant date. And the Jews eat quite a bit of sheep and goat, too. If there is anything I'm going to send you away with that is probably the best, is the various resources that you can go and read more about, references and that kind of stuff. You have some that have both sheep and goat, some sheep only, some goat only, and then some pasture ones. And you get more references from Ellen when she does it on March 29th. Reliable resources, we usually tell people if you see EDU, then you know that it is university-based research. But you come across other references like the Maryland Small Ruminant page, which doesn't have EDU on it. It is really a University of Maryland resource. And then our partners, the National Resource Conservation Service, they do have some very nice handout references. And ATRA News is a publication that is from USAID through Sustainable Ag Research and Education. It's again very nice. This book here, I like this book. It's almost a coffee table type book because you pick it up, you read a chapter, very nicely written, nice diagrams. Anybody can read this and enjoy. Again, for us here in Kankakee, we have identified, or one veterinarian, Dr. Christine Taylor, has told us that we are okay to call her clinic because there are people there that can answer your questions. Or you can write her an email. Of course, if some diseases are very, or some conditions are very complicated, she will want to see the animal and you can discuss, can she come out? And of course, that will be at a cost to you. If it is simple things that she can probably tell you about, she will do that. So those are the various things I have touched on. There are other things. There are other topics like grafting. If you have that animal that brought forth six lambs, can you take some and put them with another mother, or the process we call grafting? There are all sorts of other topics that people need to learn about. We do offer them here when we have sheep and goat workshop. And then be creative. As you go along with your enterprise, just be creative, okay? And then one professor of mine at the university told me that often with proper prior planning prevents poor performance. So do your homework before you start anything. And then, yes, that's my talk. Thank you very much. And I'm open for questions. There was a question here in Kankakee. I forgot to mention that copper is toxic to sheep. So if you buy a salt amino block for sheep or goat, make sure that the sheep don't get to it because copper accumulates in the liver of sheep and that is toxic to them. I forgot to say that.
I have a question here in Ogle County.
Yes.
What age can you breed the goats, and what's the best time of year for that?
Let me start with the second one. It's a 5-month gestation period, and you breed it around November because that gives you November, December, January, February, March. You don't want your babies coming in the middle of winter. Who wants to be out there? And I think you can breed them 1 year old. Is that correct? 1 year old, you can breed them. First year.
We have a question here.
Okay.
The question, James, is she has sheep and goats on pasture. Can they be pastured together with poultry?
They can actually, okay. There is another concept, which probably if I had more time I would have talked about. It's called commingling. A whole lot of different animals can commingle. You can have cows, you can have sheep and goats and the chickens all roaming in the same pasture. In fact, I've seen horses sometimes being roaming in the same place. And the good thing about commingling is that, okay, goats like to eat the tops of the blades of grass. They like the most nutritious part of it. They're very selfish. And then cows like to follow and eat the next so many inches of that grass. And then sheep like to follow and eat closer to the ground. And the chickens also nibble on blades of grass here and there while also picking on insects that may be roaming all over the place. In fact, the disturbance by the cows and the goats as they walk around make some insects jump all over the place, and the chickens are happy about that. Commingling is supposed to be a very good thing to do for pasture. It produces better. Yeah, you can have them mixed all over the place. That works well. Keep asking questions. I'm enjoying these questions so far. Okay, hearing none. I thank you very much for your patience. I went over time, but you stayed on, and I have enjoyed talking to you. Thank you so very much.